nu het woord geven aan onze volgende spreker. Ik heb hem al aangekondigd. Ik heb ook al gezegd dat ik zijn naam niet kan uitspreken. Ik heb al gezegd dat ik jouw naam niet kan uitspreken, Coolie. Zeg je oortjes niet. Maar ik geef je heel graag het woord. Coolie Thor, uit IJsland, vanochtend gekomen. Een heel warm welkom voor Coolie Thor.
Yeah, ladies and gentlemen, it's a pleasure to be here. And as my friend mentioned, I've been in international politics for quite a while. And I haven't yet met a person who can pronounce my name. And even though we have in common the Dutch people and the Icelandic, we have very strange languages. And that's probably the reason we are speaking English at the moment. then I am quite sure that you can never say my name, but I'm going to say it once and you can just practice a little bit afterwards. My name is Guðlaugur Þór Þórðarson. And every letter in the Icelandic alphabet, which is strange and is unique, is in my name a few times. But that's not what I'm going to talk about. I was going to talk about something which I really shouldn't talk about, because it's so natural to me, but I have got this question quite often now. How can you live without the European Union? And actually, I was in Great Britain the other day, and a journalist for BBC asked me this question, and I almost start laughing. I thought he was joking, but he meant it. He was so nervous that Great Britain was going to leave the EU. So I'm going to tell you a little bit about the European life outside the EU. And there is a European life outside the EU. And I was asked the question how we recovered so quickly as we have from the banking crisis. And I'm not going to hold a long lecture on that. It's quite simple. The things we did, and of course we haven't recovered, we haven't solved every solution, but compared to the what was predicted, we have done a lot better. We couldn't have done it if we would have been in the EU. What we did with the banks, which in short was that the owners, they lost everything. The lenders lost most of it, but we defended the deposit. We built new banks, and the old banks were with the bad assets, and they have fortunately made the most out of them and put on capital controls because of this horrible situation we were in. And this is nothing we invented. This came from what the US have been doing for a long time. We couldn't have done it if we wouldn't have had our own currency. The same is that devaluation of our currency meant that the export, they went up, tourism blossomed, and even the fisheries, which has been very in good shape in Iceland for a long time. I could also refer, we have that fisheries policy because we are outside the common fisheries policy, but it's also that, because you mentioned in this perspective, that a lot of things are leaving the EU at the moment. And one of the things that left the EU after the banking crisis was the fishing stock, the mackerel. And we made benefits from that we couldn't have done it if we had done a common fisheries policy. But the reason we want to stay out the ones as follows. I'm not going to repeat what Daniel said, especially when it comes to the democratic situation, but I think it's important to remember that it's free trade that is important. And all of the EFTA states, which is a very, it's a different states. It's Switzerland, Norway, Liechtenstein and Iceland. They have all one thing in common, which is we were all at one part in our history, very poor countries. Iceland was the poorest country in the Western Europe in the year 1900. We had no infrastructure. We had actually no towns. And but we have done quite well. But what surprised me, that both Norway and Switzerland, they were also very poor. And we would still be poor if he wouldn't have access to other markets. So free trade is the most important thing, not political integration. And the customs union, it's just not a good idea, as Dan mentioned. And actually I thought that would have been quite clear because a few years back, in 1723, in June, then Adam Smith was born. And he wrote a good book about customs and how badly it affects the average people, the consumer. And then thirdly, and I think I do not quite understand why this isn't discussed. You, for example, pay a lot into European. Where does the money go? Because if I look at the numbers and the reports, I cannot see that. And then I'm going to also mention that the common fisheries policy is a bad thing, both for taxpayers and also for the environment. And lastly, the EU regulation is a burden. As I mentioned, I'm not going to go through the customs union in detail. Dan did that effectively, like a lot of other things. But I'm going to mention EFTA, which is a free trade organization. And it means that we use it as a bloc when we are making free trade agreements, but also individually. And for example, this free trade agreement with China means that we are getting investment which had otherwise gone, for example, to the US. And I mentioned small and beautiful. And the reason I put that in is that we have found out, because I'm in the parliamentary delegation right now, and we go all around the world. I'm going to tell you a little story when we were last time in Malaysia. Of course, EFTA doesn't use the money we have for advertising EFTA. We have no song or anything. We just are a free trade organization. And so when we came to Malaysia, we met a lot of parliamentarians. And they had this flag, not the EFTA flag, the EU flag. And they were really grim when we came. And we said, no, this is a misunderstanding. We are not EU. We are just small EFTA, and I explained to them what we were. They all lightened up. Because those people, even though they're a large country, they told us they are skeptical and afraid of the big ones. They are skeptical towards China and the US and the EU. Small and beautiful EFTA. No one is afraid of EFTA. And that's something you can use in for your advantage. And it's not a natural thing to be in the EU. Here are former members, now EU member states, and the rest of the EU member states. You can see there were Finland, Sweden, Denmark, the UK, actually Britain established EFTA, and Austria, and also Portugal. And we even had a program from helping Portugal when they were in there. And because it was mentioned that you needed to be in the EU to make the free trade agreements. Well, this is how the map looks from the EFTA side. I don't know if you can see it. I'm going to let you know where there is this European, there's the blue color is for EFTA, and the light blue is for European Economic Area, which is all part of. And there, the light bluer are the light bluest, maybe. That there is the free trade agreements, and the yellow one are the ones who are negotiating, and the green one are the ones who will hopefully be concluded soon. So these are all these, and as you can see, China, there are four individual members. So we are all over, fortunately. And here you see numbers for EFTA. As you mentioned, we are maybe not the largest one, but this is an important market. And can you see this one? These are on the further are the leaders, merchandise trade, but the closest in the trade and commercial services. And even though we are that small, we are number 7 when it comes to commercial services in the world. So, when I look at these numbers, and then I think that because we will probably be at the same place as Denmark, and there's a little bit lower than Netherlands, that you were the second largest net contributor in the EU, in the Netherlands. And it's hard to see why you should pay all this money for what you're getting. But actually, because people sometimes talk about the importance of being in the EU, when I met a parliamentarian or a politician from the EU side, they have always said the same thing to me, which is, you have to be in because you have to pay like we do. You get all the benefits, you have access to the markets, but you are not paying. And I know what it means when I see this picture. And I don't know if you have looked at this one recently. This is your money, this is not ours. And if I were paying taxes in the Netherlands, I would be a little bit worried about this picture. And especially when the auditors, they say they don't know where the money goes. And I didn't believe it. I thought it was just one of these strange stories. But this is directly from the auditors' report. And this is 5% of the EU budget, which no one knows where it goes. Do you know about a firm which 5% of the auditors say, we know more or less about 95%, but this 5%, no, we have no idea. This 5% is more than the whole of the budget of the Icelandic government. It's more 1.5. Now, the common fisheries policy, it's just simple, a bad thing for taxpayers and the environment. And I think this picture shows it. This is fisheries and subsidization in all OECD countries, except one. In Iceland, fisheries are taxed. And even though this is not it doesn't look large, when we are 320,000, Dan, not 320,000.
You'd be having fun.
Yeah. Yeah. Cold winter. then this is a lot. So I think it's more likely that if you had your own fisheries policy, that you would get some tax out of it instead of subsidizing it. And I'm not going into details, but for example, that. We are environmentally very proud of our record, and I think that if you're in, you should be a little bit worried about that record in the EU, and especially when it comes to discarding. We all know that EU regulations are a burden, and the idea, as Dan mentioned, is was that you could export to all the markets in the EU. It has actually changed, but even though we have to adopt more than we would like to, we only adopt 7% of all EU legislation. And when you have, in the last 20 years, 117,000 legislation, that's quite a lot, but it's only 7%. It's 6,000 legislation per year from the EU. And I think at the end, it would be these big questions for you. Would you join the EU if you were outside now? Do you think you would look at the EU and say, we want in? And the second question, can EU be saved? Dan mentioned, how often do you see referendum? You see elections results. He says, now we have some changes. But am I the only one who doesn't see any changes? So how are you going to save it, and how are you going to change it? And lastly, who runs the EU? Is it Netherlands? The parliamentarians, European parliaments, or the Netherlands? Good to meet someone who actually thinks he's in charge. Or can affect. And lastly, I'm going to mention things which I think is something that you should look into as politicians and taxpayers in this country. That we are, the average age in the world is, if you look at that, then you show that
Europe is the one who is is the oldest continent. The oldest countries in the world are the Japanese and Germany. And as you can see, Europe is getting quite old. This is not the, both good and bad. Of course, it's just because the living standards are high and we're living longer and so on. But we probably need some money to pay for all of it. And actually, the Netherlands are very well funded when it comes to the pension funds. But they are one of the very few countries with that position. And what surprised me is not that Greece hasn't got anything, and they retire at 55 years old. But that Germany, they have 5% of the GDP. And other countries in the old Europe. And I don't know, when I look at these numbers, I see problems. I don't know how it will come into force, but I think this will mean problems for the EU in the near future, even though you do not have a common pension system or anything like that. We just see that there is a problem in one country, it will be a problem in the others. So, lastly, what are you waiting for? Come and join us in EFTA. Thank you.